Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our Business Immigration Best Practices for 2020. Well, it's quite interesting to be having this seminar on the morning of one of the proclamation, which is limiting by our president, which limited travel for people entering the country, foreign nationals coming from the Schengen area. I mean, which is going to be a huge impact. Welcome. We're going to mention a few issues related to the coronavirus issue as well. We've got issues on, we're going to cover kind of new issues on our I-9 issues and some current business immigration kind of visa processing and strategies to combat what's happening right now in the field. And then we've also got some other updates that we'll cover. So I think we will, I want to go right into, I've head up our business immigration practice here in the Atlanta office of Baker Donaldson. I got my introduction to all things international. I lived a couple years in Japan, so I speak Japanese, and I came and Georgia's home to 600 Japanese companies, so law firm worked with Jones Day initially for about 10 years, and then in the international section, and now at Baker Donaldson. So we have minasan ohayou gozaimasu, good morning, and we'll continue here now. I wanted to go for a couple housekeeping notes. Q&A, please submit your questions. As we go along here, we'll tell us your feedback and complete the survey at the end of the webinar. And then the PDF of the presentation will be available in the resource list. It will be emailed to attendees in the coming days. And connect with us, Baker Donaldson. The Twitter link is at the bottom of your screen. So, well, as we'll dive right in here, as I mentioned, in particular, all the multinational companies that we represent in connection with our business immigration practice, all have certainly, we work with so many companies that have global operations with foreign national employees working in the United States. And there's been questions come up about now, in connection with the coronavirus, about recommending, you know, remotely, staff working remotely. And so that's just raised a few questions that we'll just cover quickly. Before that, again, I think generally all of our, I'm sure all of you have already have seen kind of these sample type advisories and certainly recommended as far as the foreign national communities that we work with. We all have to be sensitive about where travel might be restricted and discouraged. So I just had these couple of slides as a kind of a notice, samples of notices that companies are publishing and being very vigilant and watching carefully. But the questions related to this working from home policy impact on immigration compliance issues, just four questions here. Do I need to submit an amended petition or LCA for an H or L employee to work from home? How does this affect LCA notice posting rules? And what if I have a non-immigrant employee facing a max out expiration or denial during this time? And then does the work site change affect wage obligations? And just again, very briefly, for an H-1B employee, an amended petition or LCA should not be required as long as the employee is in the working in the same capacity and within the community distance of the work location at the original petition for the LCA, that labor condition application. And then also for L-1s, generally, this temporarily working from home in virtually the same capacity, an amended petition is not should not be required. Again, the second question there about the LCA posting, Again, DOL guidance indicates LCA posting is required at any work site, but it's a reasonable interpretation that the DOL's definition of the work site does not include work from home arrangement. So just wanted to, then the third question, if you're facing a max out, again, closely monitor anybody who's here on a, I mentioned here the 180-day rule. You want to be sure that no one is in violation of an overstay for more than 180 days. But for most of our business immigration folks, the here that are here either on temporary visas or as visitors, that certainly we could certainly get into an issue as far as their immigration status. If there is somebody that might be timing out, it might be if the travel is restricted, then you can always, generally from any of the work visa categories, we are able to change status to a visitor status and file an application to change from an H or an L or a J to B1, B2 visitor status to allow them to stay in the country. And of course, you wouldn't have them on the U.S. payroll. And in theory, they could be kind of maybe doing some work for a company or affiliate abroad. But again, those are things that you just watch out for. Does the worksite change? No. Just again, it's has no impact on the wage responsibility. Okay, well, I think we'll want to keep this moving. We really are covering a lot. I'm going to. I wanted to make sure we've got some I-9 breaking news. Of course, I-9. We haven't had a revised I-9 form for some time now, and so just want to give everybody a heads up that there's a new form to be put in use as of January 31st, 2020, and you can use the prior version until April 30th, but to make sure that everyone is on board with the new form. And just a quick review of some of the changes, really minor changes. One of the things they clarified is, again, this authorized representative for reviewing the documents. Anyone, and you may designate an authorized representative to act on your behalf to complete Section 2. An authorized representative can be any person you designated to complete the sign and form I-9 on your behalf. So really, it's anyone that you want to designate. Just again, some changes on the minor changes on the I-9 form. I think more important is looking ahead. The budget, new budget, White House budget included an increase in spending with respect to some really high tech systems. HSI is undertaking a major effort to automate I-9 form audits. It is a, there's a couple of new things that are coming on board this year. The couple systems they call Hawk and Raven, again, with money for additional officers. So it's very, kind of the thinking is that it's very likely that the government will be encouraged to turn its sights to even larger employers. So I think the larger employers sometimes have the number of I-9s on record has kind of been almost a deterrent, but will that be the case. Like no company will be too big for an I-9 inspection. So what do employers do now? I think I'm personally in the middle of assisting some clients with I-9 audits, and and even some inspections that have taken place. So we want to just be sure that now is the time to review your I-9s and your compliance policies to minimize exposure should the government show up at your doorstep demanding to see your I-9s. Actually, on that point, there's going to be some policy changes coming down that where they won't even be showing up. They're just going to be sending a certified letter for inspection to kind of cut down on the need for the officers to be out in the field. So again, what we have seen, we've seen in recent years the I-9 inspections by the government, ICE and HSI, Homeland Security Investigation. They've increased literally threefold, and then worksite investigations also increased. So we want to be sure that you've got everything in order. Also, potential fines have been increasing as well. Even arrests and criminal convictions for knowingly hiring or employing up unauthorized workers have gone up. So again, I think that because of increased emphasis on this enforcement and the new digital tools soon to be in the government's arsenal to combat immigration issues, the time is now for you to ensure you are in compliance. Again, this is not new, and I think a best practices tips, establish a uniform written I-9 compliance policy, avoid discrimination claims by educating staff. I think most people that are processing I-9s know that you how to handle kind of those issues, not dictating what documents to see, but giving that to the choice of the candidate. Create a tickler system to notify HR staff of upcoming verifications. Establish a best practice method for cataloging retention and destruction of I-9s. Keep I-9s organized and separate from employee files, and then conduct routine and formalized self audits. Document the internal audit as well. Just a quick wrap. This is where we go. For all things I-9, the I-9 Central really at DHS.gov is the great source. I think that. Really, I wanted to, again, that kind of wraps up the I-9 portion. Right now, I guess we have more, it seems like everything's breaking. We've got this H-1B, I want to dive right into some of the business immigration issues. H-1B electronic registration process, I mean, this is huge. This is in December 2019, the USCIS announced that it would implement the electronic registration process for this fiscal year. And we are in the middle of that process right now. If you have anyone college graduate, foreign national college graduates that is currently working under their OPT, now is the time to look to get registered. Again, February 24th was just the date to begin. Representatives may create an account at any time. March 1 is registration period opened, and then it'll be closing here on the 20th. And then by the 31st, the USCIS is intended to notify the selected registrants. This is really a big change because for the first time, you know, we have not had to be rushing to complete all of the entire petition package and file it, you know, that first week in April. So the H-1B employers simply, again, this registration process has been it's been very streamlined. Our experience has been it's worked out well. Clients have been able to get on and create an account, and then we've been able to work with them to get the individuals registered. The information is relatively, again, very, very brief and limited information is required for the registration, just basic name, gender, date of birth, country of birth, citizenship, passport, and then the degree. So it's really, I think it's, hopefully it's going to, it's saved clients a lot of cost, a lot of expense of having to actually, again, prepare the petitions, file them that first week in April, only to have about 50% of them actually just returned, the entire petition returned because of this, the oversubscription on the numbers. So we hope that, again, that this will be a, that this will work. Well, we have, after April 1, then we'll have the last point there. The earliest date that be filed is April 1, after we're notified, and then we'll have 90-day period to file the, to complete the petitions and file the actual petition for adjudication. Now, just to get out very quickly here and in summary fashion, the best practices for employers as far as any business immigration, your non-immigrant, your immigrant visa applications, again, the best practice involves watching out for the expiration dates and file extensions early, 6 months ahead. And the reason for that is because we are experiencing just a record number of requests for evidence. Even on the extensions, the government came down with a White House policy that it was going to treat these as new cases, and the fact that it has already been approved essentially would not make any difference. They're going to essentially treat it, every even extension, as a new case. And we've seen really onerous requests for evidence on extensions and denials. So, again, to get that process started early, prefer for tough interviews. We always recommend, of course, for our non-immigrant interviews at the consulates abroad, of course, that they're very that the applicants for the visas for which they're applying are very familiar with all of the documentation that was filed on their behalf, particularly in the petition. Is required very extensive job descriptions, and want to make sure that they are aware of what of everything that was submitted to the government. Because if they're in the interview and they don't their description of what they're doing is different for whatever reason, different than what's on the petition, we have a problem. Also, we have interviews now for all employment-based green card applications. Now, fortunately, I've actually been to a number of these interviews, and they are not, I certainly wouldn't classify them as tough. We certainly are careful to have everything in order as far as the job that they're accepting as of the date of that interview, which should be matching up with the job that was certified and the job which was petitioned for. For the most part, though, my experience has been that the officers are really looking at a lot of the questions in the I-485 application itself about all the potential illegal activities that they question in that I-485. And but again, prepare. We want all of our employment sponsored green card applicants to be prepared for those interviews. On all the petitions, articulate and document the obvious, even for, like I mentioned, even for extensions. I-9 audit, e-verifying visa compliance periodically, again, just the self-auditing, will go a long way. I had a client who was formally notified of an inspection, and they had just finished an audit about 6 months prior to, and so it made really the response to the audit really went fairly smoothly and quickly. And now and what's interesting is that once you respond to an audit like that, they can take months to get back. But the point is that you can meet their deadline in getting the copies of the I-9s to them in order in due time. Okay, take special care of student CPT. That's curricular practical training and optional practical training. There's been more scrutiny of when you're trying to change status from a student to the business visa to H-1B, for example, and they are asking for the documentation related to all OPT time and even the jobs that they were doing. Under OPT, we have extensions now under the STEM occupations, and again, those are all things that you want to be sure the students are coordinating with the International Student Service Offices, the ISO, the ISSO office, to be sure that they are staying in compliance with their F1 rules on keeping their OPT in place. Be prepared for on-site visit. Anticipate delays in adjudication interviews. Again, this has really been, we've been facing delays literally on every front. Thankfully, our premium processing is still a great option for many of our petitions. Don't let vendors violate immigration rules on your sites. Again, that's I-9 related, because you can always be kind of be liable as a co-employer for these kind of violations. Check for wage disparities. There's, again, in connection with our H-1B particularly, we have wage requirements to watch out for. Okay, I think just quick rundown on the best practices, but I wanted to cover a couple challenges that are facing our H-1B. There's been a rise. There's been about a 30% increase in denials of H-1Bs. And really, it's related to this whole definition. It's almost as if the government is rewriting the definition of specialty occupation. It's been really, really challenging. If there are really, to put it very briefly, if there are any occupations or jobs that you might be sponsoring for an H-1B, if there's any chance within that occupation that you have workers working in that same occupation that are not degreed, or that have degrees in different areas, then that's what opens it up to the request for evidence, saying, "Well, this is an occupation that doesn't necessarily require a bachelor's degree. Therefore, we have to further justify why you are requiring a degree." That's the nature of the request for evidence that we've been getting, and in response, we've been, let me go back to that. In response to the on this issue of specialty occupation, we've had professors who have helped us to write the expert opinion letters. And even recently, there's been cases where the immigration has rejected those letters. And their response has been that, "Hey, this professor, we appreciate his letter, but his or her letter, but we note that the professor's never been to the company, has no idea where this employee is working, so we're just not going to take that into account." And so what we're doing now is actually setting the professors up for a virtual interview with the supervisor, the actual H-1B employee, so they can actually, again, conduct a virtual interview. They can see them. They can see each other, talk to each other, see the workplace. And it has resulted in some very strong expert opinion letters, of course, because they can say, hey, I have been there virtually. And my experience is that it's resulted in swift approvals. I think that finally they're certainly accepting those letters. Again, just a note on the H-1B challenges, really with the rise of the request for evidence on that. I think that, of course, everyone who files H-1Bs is well aware of the prevailing wage requirement. Again, again, you have a 3-year and then you have a 6-year. It can be extended to 6 years. Again, kind of a best practice on working with H-1Bs is to certainly be cognizant of their time in H-1B status, and then be considering working towards a permanent resident status. In time to allow them, if you have the green card in process, then the applicants can remain beyond the 6-year limit if you're far enough along in that process. And that's certainly something to discuss with your legal counsel. Okay, and of course we've got this annual cap. I guess on the, again, the good news this year, we've just got people registered. So they will, from the individuals that have registered, they will select and will be notified. Okay, we're still dealing with this Buy American, Hire American Executive Order 2017, but it's had some real impacts. And so it's, again, what I mentioned is about the extensions. Again, we've had this huge increase in requests for evidence. Other challenges on the H-1B side, this third-party site crackdown. Employees, if you have an H-1B employee that's working at a third site, that's where it's really the immigration, USCIS has been challenging really hard the documentation required to establish the employer-employee relationship and also the workload for the employee has to be documented for, 1 to 2 to 3 years out. There have actually been some very serious challenges. In fact, we just had by the IT industry, consulting industry. And in fact, there was a big decision that came down just yesterday that really is putting questions some of these actions that are considered policy but really are in effect a change in the law and so are being turned around. So I think that we're seeing a little lightening up on that. But again, there's always been our wage issues. You want to look at that more closely at the outset. If a person is coming to you from a different company, then we want to make sure that the wage level is at a level where that you won't be challenged on that. Again, I mentioned this specialty occupation issue, and then back up with the expert opinion. Okay. Now, best practices is that you don't forget the H-1B alternatives. We have Singapore, Malaysia, of course. We have TN, NAFTA professionals, Mexico, Canada. I'll tell you, the TN is a real boon. For bringing folks from Canada. Of course, there's a specified list, and it's treated much like the H-1B. Person's essentially got to have a minimum of a bachelor's degree. There is a consulting one, management consultant category where if they have a certain number of years of experience in the field, they can be granted that category. Then, of course, you have E3 Australia. So we certainly have, these have been categories that have helped companies to meet labor shortage demands. Another kind of, that's been a kind of a visa, almost a visa category of last resort, a J-1 18-month stay for a trainee. Again, if you have, its application is limited because you have to have somebody who has a bachelor's degree from outside the U.S. and 1 year experience, or 5 years experience in the field. But it actually, in some cases, where you have somebody out in the U.S. and you really would like them here for to acclimate as far as bringing them here maybe to get again some training. It's a training category, but it's on the job training, so you really can be putting them to work. But you part of the J-1 requirement is, of course, do you have a training program with particular supervisors in different stages, but again, it has really worked out well for a lot of companies to be able to actually bring someone in where there's no H-1B option, and they may not have the option for the L-1 for an intercompany transfer. So I note here to be careful about the 2-year homestay requirement. Go to travel.state.gov for the skills list, and then you can be sure that you avoid a 2-year homestay requirement. INA, Immigration Nationality Act 212E is the statutory section. Okay, J-1, then I wanted to really jump into L-1. L-1, all of our multinational clients will utilize this L-1 visa category again, so many, many companies are global now with subsidiaries and affiliates outside the United States, and the transfer of people from those companies, from their companies and affiliates outside the United States to the United States, is part of their business culture. And so this L-1 has worked, of course, for that purpose, but secondly, to really, companies have been utilizing this as a way to bring in a real qualified and highly skilled workforce because they've got experience with, you have to have at least, again, a year experience working with a related company abroad, and within the last 3 years. And again, there's two types: managers and executives, and specialized knowledge are the workers that can qualify for the L-1. Now, the petitions are under scrutiny, but again, we're still getting approvals on the L-1s. Again, these are some notes that are taken from the government's requests for evidence to give you an idea of the detail that the government is requiring on these petitions right now. Again, it's really dig deep on the knowledge that they have both abroad and if they have any in the U.S. market already. And how they've acquired the specialized knowledge, again, knowledge of a product or process, how you qualify these. Now, I did want to also address the L-1 blanket option, and the reason that if you've got 10 L-1s approvals, it's for essentially multinational business. You have to have three or more operations outside the U.S., entities outside the U.S. with employees, and if you're in that class and you have you've done at least 10 L1s in the last 12 months, or you have global sales, at least 25 million U.S. sourced sales, or have a U.S. workforce of at least 1,000, you can apply for this blanket. And the blanket has been really a huge boon to our multinational and global corporations, because essentially on the blanket petition, you list every company from which you may have a transfer. You may want to transfer somebody to any U.S. operation as well. So all of those companies are included on the blanket as far as like your company group, the group of global companies, all listed on the blanket. And then with that approval notice, the individual can go directly to the U.S. consulate in the country that they reside and where they're working and apply for this blanket for the individual L1 visa based on that approved blanket. So you bypass the individual petition process at the USCIS. And it's at that individual petition process where we're seeing such onerous requests for evidence. So if we can move clients to a blanket, we're definitely recommending that. The consular officers are have been very reasonable in their adjudication of the L1 blanket petitions, and fair, reasonable and fair, and continue to be so. So we're, in some of the high use countries, we are seeing some pushback, some requests for additional evidence. But for the most part, we've had very good experience with this blanket petition. If you have, again, if you have any work kind of entities outside the U.S. for which you might be able to access really high skilled labor, this L1 blanket is is definitely a recommended and in the top of the list for now all of our multinational clients. Let's see, what is next? Okay, of course we can't forget about our extraordinary people. Our foreign national of extraordinary ability. This is an oft-used O-1 visa category. Again, you got to be top of your field in science, education, business, athletics, or the arts. Arts means a distinction, so it's a little different level of proof than extraordinary. It's one notch down, but again, three of these eight categories you meet, and we can qualify for the O-1. I wanted to show the O-1 category because then also it can be a generally someone who has applied, who qualifies for this O-1 status, can also then apply for a green card based on, again, the EB-1 category of persons of extraordinary ability. So it is one interesting note about the O-1 is that it is it can be extended indefinitely as long as the person is working in that field and using their extraordinary skills. Again, so I just note the three of eight, but I would probably add that what they really want to see is someone working in a critical, that number seven, employment in a critical or essential capacity, you know, for distinguished organizations. Really, I would say that is probably the number one thing they want to see. Okay, I think all of our next on our list, I say the best practices for 2020 You have to look far and wide and dig deep for options. And the E1 is another category that's was oft used by our business immigration clients. There is a list at travel.state.gov of treaty countries, which is really all most of all the it's just a, the list is very long, where we have treaties, and it allows the a German-owned, a Japanese-owned, a French-owned, Italian-owned company to hire French nationals if it's a French company, German nationals if it's a German company, in managerial or what we call essential skills positions. So it is a, again, this is a oft-used category for our multinational clients that have ownership of a particular citizenship country that is on the list. Again, so many of the countries around the world. So many times we will have our multinational clients set up. We will be using both the E and the L. Sometimes the E comes in very handy because there's not necessarily a 1 year prior employment requirement. This came up recently for one of our large companies where they had a really highly skilled professional they wanted to bring on, but we couldn't qualify him under the L1 because he didn't have a full 1 year of employment. He did have some months of training. But had other skills that proved, and we qualified him under the E visa. So the E visa can be, or if you're moving somebody from a different company, again, you don't have the L1 prior employment experience requirement. Again, there's minimum investment requirements, of course, but again, for most of our companies who are making sizable investments in the U.S., that's generally not an issue. Although certainly even the smaller companies, you'd be surprised we get even a restaurant, French restaurant, Japanese restaurants have qualified under this category, owned by nationals of those countries, and then they can bring in qualified kind of essential skilled folks for to work for the company. Okay, I wanted to spend just a few minutes. Can't believe this time is running quickly by. On the immigrant visas, the green cards, kind of a just a real quick overview. Of course, we have in our practice, the subject of green card, of course, comes up and up and up because we have our non-immigrant visa holders whose time is limited. Our L1. The H-1B. One note on the E is that fortunately there's not a limitation. Those are also indefinite. For the green card, we have the family. Does this give you a very good overview? Quick overview. Family-based. We have employment-based. We have per-country limits that cause us this angsting about the number of years that we have our immigrants. Even our applicants waiting, go to travel.state.gov, the visa bulletin. That is a, now it's even become, it's become a really complex because there's now dates for filing, dates which you can actually file your application, even though the visa is not available, these wait periods. And then there are a second set of dates for when you're able to actually then file, you can file, and then the dates when their visas will actually become available for final adjudication. Again, the areas we have first preference employment, who's the extraordinary ability, foreign nationals, outstanding research, managerial. Many of your L1A managers have this streamlined process to the green card. So if you have any, again, and the the upside to the first preference category is that you avoid the need for this labor certification. That's the processing through the Department of Labor. That is bypassed, and you can file an immigrant petition, an application for permanent residence, you know, at the concurrently at the same time. For the first time in many, many years, we've actually had a backlog even on some of the our EB1 categories. So watch the visa bulletin carefully for that as well. Second preference, again, EB2, and then you have EB3, again, as part of the employment-based categories. Just one of the, if you have employees that are H-1B, like I mentioned, the planning for the H-1B, moving them to green card should start, you know, in the fourth, I would recommend in the fourth year, at least by the fourth year, in their limited six years, because you'll likely have to be looking at a Department of Labor perm processing, labor certification, and then which are taking about a year to get through, and then with that completed, then we can file an immigrant petition, and actually we can get premium processed on that, which then allows, once we have an immigrant petition approved, then we can extend that H-1B for three-year increments until we're able to go to the step three for filing of the application for permanent residence. I did want to make a note. There's a new form, I-944 Declaration of Self-Sufficiency, in connection with that I-45 application for permanent residence. Must demonstrate not inadmissible based on public charge. Really, there's been a lot of controversy around this, but it looks like it's here to stay, and we are already filing these really extensive and onerous disclosures that have to be made on this form, and it's really, wow, it's almost draconian, but it's a way, and we have to be really vigilant about advising our foreign national community that are here on temporary, they're here temporarily, that may want to look to adjust to permanent residence one day, about the kind of public benefits they might apply for, because the officer many times is going to be an officer's determination if they think that for whatever reason the person might be become a public charge. It doesn't come up a lot for our clients, because of course they're here, they're usually here in good jobs and well paid, and but it's interesting the what's required on this declaration of self-sufficiency now. So you might just be aware of that, to be sensitive to what your employees are having to go through in connection with this final step in the green card process. If you've gone through this labor certification, again, just a kind of a best practices is that you look to other positions, and you establish kind of a fair minimum requirements, and then you don't want to tailor the requirements to that position, and you want to have consistency among, again, the training and experience and special requirements for the particular position that's being certified for the green card purposes. Again, I think you don't want to be, there's just, again, things that you look at in connection with kind of preparation of labor certification to watch out for the occupational codes. Make sure you're kind of sitting in the right occupational code, and then the training that you're requiring. And then, of course, you have part of the first process of the labor certification is filing for this prevailing wage. Once you have that, then you know where you are, and then you can continue on with the processing of the labor certification. Oh, industry standard requirements for the position. And then, again, just be careful of, over restrictive requirements. They can require you to file a additional information on business necessity if they deem them to be too excessive. Okay, on this last one, my goodness, it's wow, we're at the last stage here. I did want to I include one section on marriage-based green card. Sometimes I do a presentation to student to many university students, and I in the corporate. Some people might think, well, what are we doing talking about marriage-based, where this is a corporate immigration seminar? Well, many people in our corporate environment, the question comes up about marriage to a U.S. citizen and the immigration aspect of that. And so, yes, we help. We actually the companies are the companies will often support the application, even the application for a marriage-based. Because they don't have to endure this the process of the labor certification, so I include this just to be aware. There is a streamlined process in place for the application process, and then the obtaining. Generally, once you apply, you have a 3 to 4 month wait before you then get a combo card. It's an employment card and a travel document in the same card. So they've got this down to a pretty good streamlined process. I must say that all the marriage-based cases we've filed for clients, pretty much 100% all have gone through fairly smoothly, and have good experiences at the final interview on their interviews. Okay, I think we're going to wrap up. We're going to wrap up here with with the H-1B. We do have. This is talked about a lot in the news, and it has for many years that we have a broken, immigration system, and employers have been doing what they can, to petition Congress for comprehensive immigration reform. You know, even what we're facing, right now. With this, we have so many foreign students at universities, and then they graduate, with the bachelor's and master's degrees, and then they obtain this OPT, which can be extended for the STEM, but nonetheless, if any of you have employed these students on OPT, it's stressful because then they have to jump into this H-1B with lottery and with this. Essentially, again, your continued stay here is up to a lottery, and so is very very tough on employers and employees. Makes it very difficult for planning ahead and for your labor long-term labor needs. One interesting this is just again the number that. The number of oversubscriptions on this H-1B lottery is really, really tough to work with. Just very quickly, a couple of interesting studies that they've done, the L-1 and the H-1B, just quick myths to debunk. The wages, we have the prevailing wage requirement for the H-1B, so H-1B employers are paying fair wages. The L1, in my experience, all of our L1 employees, they're at market rate because the companies are transferring them here, and they end up in the same wage rate as their cohorts here in the U.S. And really, from the studies and what I've even observed personally, I've seen the L1 and the H-1B professionals help expand the U.S. economy. And in fact, they've estimated that 10 new jobs are created for each L1 or H-1B professional hire. So I think that with that, I finished just a few minutes early. This is fantastic. We certainly can take any questions. If not, it looks like we do. Let's see, do I have a Q&A here? Oh, define... We have a question here about defining public charge. That's actually one of the controversial things about this law. It's really bad. I mean, it's been challenged. But again, public charge is essentially someone who's you become dependent on the government benefits for survival, essentially. So it's pretty. I mean, it's like I say, it's unlikely that any of our people will do that. Will reach that point. But the point is that we don't want to be in a situation where we have claimed filed for kind of public benefits that might bring up any question. Let's see. There's a question here, Carol Wolf, about the upgrade. Any update on the OPT backlog? I know that's been a struggle for so many of our universities, and well, no, not a univ all of our employers, and that is, I really unfortunately don't have. I will. Tell you what I'll do. I'll check to see if there's anything recent on that, Carol, and see if I can get back to you. Let's see. We have if employees are quarantined or unable to sign documents. There's a question about quarantine. Unable to sign documents prior to employees' expiration date. Do you envision USA allowing for late filings? I would absolutely think that a filing. Under the we use the Latin term nunc pro tunc. I am almost 100% sure that you would probably get some you would get some consideration on something that was really something out of your control. And generally they want to see some documentation to support that, but absolutely. I think we'll see that. Let's see. Do I have any other questions? Is there a requirement for source income, U.S. source? Is there a requirement either for U.S. source income or for U.S. workforce, or at least? Okay. I'm not sure. I think that that came from Mr. Vega on public charge. Well, if there are no, I'll try to answer. Maybe we can talk offline, Mr. Vega. If there are no other questions, I think. Oh wait, we have another one coming in. Okay. Is there a U.S. citizen hire quota? 10 citizens employed for EB1. I think that might be a question. Let's see. Actually, there is not a quota. There's not a quota for the L1. For the L1 for the L1 EB1s or the other EB1 categories. So, and there's no, let's see, is there a U.S. citizen hire quota? 10 U.S. citizens employed for EB1. No. The answer to that is no. I'm wondering if you might be there's a employment creation visa category EB5, which does require a 10 jobs to be created, so maybe in connection with the investment, but there's no magic number here for citizen hire quota. Okay. Oh, we've got more. Let's see. Okay. Well, I think we've got some questions answered, and I think we're in good shape, and we're here at the last hour. So I really want to thank everyone for letting us get this broad overview together, and best to all of us as we work through this challenge, our coronavirus world pandemic here. It's like, wow, we're all going to be in for a tough road ahead here, hopefully for a short term, but good luck to us all and in all of our dealings with our foreign national communities. Thank you so much.